Whoever would overthrow the liberty of a nation must begin by subduing the freedom of speech. Benjamin Franklin, 1722.
There is a problem today that affects every single social and political issue that you might care about. From education, healthcare, the ongoing wars, reproductive rights, fair elections, veterans' rights, gay rights, minority issues, immigration, tax policy, or corruption in government. That overarching problem is media consolidation. The impact from media consolidation touches on all our lives, yet is largely unknown to most Americans. We turn to some media experts to help explain this complex subject. Traditional media, television, newspapers, and radio is where most Americans get their information about how to vote, what policies to support, and what governmental actions will affect their lives. With deregulated media, that information is filtered. Fewer and fewer corporations own a vast majority of media outlets, and as a result, it has become increasingly difficult to get unbiased facts about the issues facing the American public. Facts that are often in opposition to the financial interests of the media corporations or the political leanings of these owners. I'm John Elliott, and as a nationally syndicated radio talk show host, I've experienced the impact media consolidation has had on controlling and in many cases stifling liberal talk. Media consolidation has had a disastrous and debilitating effect on our democracy, and it just may get worse. This documentary will shed light on this problem and explore possible solutions. We look at a small 5,000-watt liberal talk radio station in San Diego and its struggle to stay on the air. This station, KLSD, is owned by Clear Channel Communications, the largest owner of radio stations in the country.
All of this was going through my mind in August 2007 when I learned that our only, lonely, local radio station, KLSD 1360, was being threatened with shutdown. As a former television journalist and a progressive radio host in San Diego and Los Angeles, I started to wonder, where would we get the rest of the story?
Now, broadcasting from a clandestine secret location inside a concrete fortified steel-enforced bunker, armed only with his wit, a digital uplink to the transmitter, and a couple of bottles of Mickey's malt liquor, this is Stacy Taylor on San Diego's Progressive Talk. AM 1360.
Hey, thank you and good morning. Welcome to the Stacy Taylor Show. It is the Monday edition. I ran into some people in the parking lot out there getting ready for a big protest today, big rally. Show up. It's not too late. I'm getting email. I got an email this morning at 4:20. Heard you might be changing formats. Is there a protest? Yeah. And we can always count on the Union Tribune. Local Air America fans to hold rally. Online buzz has local Air America outlet KLSD AM 1360 on the verge of dropping its progressive talk format, but fans of the station aren't waiting quietly for the axe to fall. A rally has been organized to save San Diego's only progressive talk station, which airs shows featuring Ed Schultz, Tom Hartman, Randy Roach, and local radio veteran Stacy Taylor. The rally will take place 7:30 a.m. Monday at the Clear Channel office, 9660 Granite Ridge Drive in Mission Village.
I want to support the station. I want to keep it going. I think it's vital to democracy to have, a spectrum of opinion.
50% of San Diego is made up of Democrats. A good percentage of them don't want to listen to Roger Hedgecock, don't want to listen to Rush Limbaugh, but they do enjoy talk radio.
John Elliott, I believe, is outside. We got a little tent set up out there. John, you there?
I am, Stacy. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
Oh, you should see it out here. It's really quite extraordinary. It hasn't even started yet, and yet it started. There's a lineup of people, and they're parading around with signs. And we've come too far to turn back now. Save our station, KLSD. 25 stations have flipped from progressive talk to whatever, mostly sports, and not one of them has even come close to the ratings they had as progressive talk.
Marjorie, thanks for coming out and supporting the rally. What brought you out?
Well, what brought me out was I just happened to be reading James Madison's Federalist Papers, and he said that a democracy can only survive when people have the access to information.
You know, conservatives, liberals, progressive, independents have at least one thing in common, and that is they believe dissent and alternative voices is part of America and part of this republic, and it is patriotic to criticize your country when your country needs criticism. We don't own that. The left doesn't own that. The right doesn't own that. We Americans own that.
So the word went out to come together, to show that KLSD had community support, that in fact it could generate profits for the owner of the radio station, Texas-based Clear Channel. The second largest city in California had just one progressive talk radio station. KLSD, short for Liberal San Diego, was it. Local activist Barbara Cummings was among the first to hear the rumor that KLSD might change formats.
The very first inkling that I got that something might be wrong, and it was from my friend Nancy Cunningham in Dallas. They used to have Air America Radio in Dallas and lost their station about a year and a half, almost 2 years ago. And she sent me an email and said, I hear you're maybe losing your radio station. No. Where would you hear a thing like that? Our radio station is really popular. It's very successful.
When it's trickling down from on high in the corporation, you know, obviously they knew about it in Dallas before we knew about it in San Diego. Well, let's see. Clear Channel is from Texas.
Texas, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, good figure.
Well, we have to concentrate on what's going on with the FCC and with Congress because this isn't going to be corrected if we just leave it to capitalism. What I like to say is unbridled capitalism kills democracy.
Stacey Taylor hosted a morning drive time program about national and local political issues. He provided a progressive viewpoint and an irreverent tone. It was a fun show with occasional guests and frequent listener calls. And believe me, it inspired fierce loyalty.
Dial us up, 858-560-1360. That is the telephone number. And look, we got a little Mikey from Ramona, I think, has a rant for us. Hey, Mikey, what's going on?
What's going on, gentlemen? I'm glad to see Mr. Mondays there to document this, the fingertips of the Bush crime family trying to pull out the plug here in San Diego and silence the voice of the average citizenry, the disgruntled, the outcast, the voiceless that you've all given voice to, gentlemen. And to pull out the plug on KLSD is an outrage of the first order. Where else is anyone going to go? To the Anti-Union Tribune? To all the right-wing talk radio stations? Thank you. Peace out.
Thank you, Mikey. The president admitted to seeing ghosts coming out of the Lincoln bedroom. In a different and a more rational era, the utterances of this man would not only have him out of the White House, he would be in the proverbial rubber room, okay? He would have his sleeves tied behind his back. It's a cruel joke, friends. We will take a break, 7:30. More phone calls coming up. If you're on line, Glenn and Jane and David and Jesse and the rest of you, please don't go away. 858-560-1360. This is KLSD.
The unstable status of KLSD was not an isolated case. We came to find out that other progressive talk stations were changing formats also, such as in Boston, Massachusetts, Columbus, Ohio, and Madison, Wisconsin. In Wisconsin, at least, listener protests actually led to a restoration of the progressive talk format there. So why would KLSD change formats? Was it a business decision, or were politics involved?
And you know what? This station has had, over the last 3 years, thanks to people like Stacy, the longest, it ranks number one in time spent listening in our group of radio stations.
But there's two things that make up ratings. Time spent listening, how long do they listen to you, and the number of people. The time spent listening, I was number one in San Diego. Advertisers look at time spent listening, TSL it's called, because they want to see if I can hold the audience through the commercials so that their commercial gets heard by my audience. The second part of the rating, of the whole number that you hear, is number of people. If you can put together 100,000 people, which is what we had, and combine it with 4 or 5 hours a week of listening, that is the ball game.
The AM 1360 signal is not the strongest AM signal in the market, and but it is very strong in the 80% of where the people live in San Diego County, we are we're as strong as any other AM station. I'm just telling you, that's the way it is.
You know,
it is not as strong as other AM stations.
How many of you people out there have trouble sometimes listening?
Yeah!
The story is not that we failed. The story is that we succeeded against all odds on low power signals, which was all we had access to. So when you get 1% of the audience, that's a third of their audience. Now they go, oh, they have a one share. They only have a three share. We have a third of what they have, and we were growing. Yeah. That's a threat.
KLSD is a case study for what's happening all across America. It's called media consolidation. Radio stations are increasingly owned by a handful of large companies. Clear Channel Communications, Cumulus, which owns the second highest number of radio stations and is merging with the third largest, Citadel. We are losing localism and diversity of views on the airwaves, our airwaves. In fact, a report found that 90% of political talk radio programming is conservative. What a surprise.
Why is it such an uphill battle for liberals on talk radio?
Well, you know, I just did a panel on the fairness doctrine, and I have to tell you, I brought ratings information, and people like me and Ed Schultz are consistently beating conservative shows in many, many markets, and yet there is 10% liberal radio in this country, 90% of the stations are conservative, and you just cannot argue anymore that it's because liberal radio can't compete. We are, you know, I'm not for the fairness doctrine, but I'm for fairness. You know, you can bring up any market. I mean, Howard, you bring up Washington. That's actually a good point. The station had no signal, no format that's ever been on that station got ratings. So, but they have that same company has a right-wing station that has no better ratings, and they didn't drop that format.
Radio became a part of the press more than a century after the founding of our country. Truly a mass media available to all for free.
From 1912, the Radio Act of 1912, that the spectrum, which the, you know, the air through which we broadcast our programs, our stations, that air was a public good. It was a public property, just like a national park. And the idea that we used in this country to set up a media system was we allowed private corporations the chance to use that spectrum. You get a license. The license guarantees you a protected spot on the dial. If you're a radio operator, no one else can broadcast over your station. You know, everyone has to respect the fact that you have 96.5 and I have 98.7. But in exchange for getting that license, we as media companies would then promise you, the public, that we will serve your interests.
I think I might sound like a radical if I say, you know, you bring back the fairness doctrine, or you should have some sort of way of saying to news organizations, look, if you're going to occupy spectrum space, if you're going to occupy broadcast space on television or radio, a certain portion of what you do has to be dedicated not to making a profit, but to the greater good.
In 1934, the United States passed a Communications Act that created the FCC.
The goal of the FCC historically has been to promote competition, localism, and diversity. I don't see how media consolidation promotes any of those goals. As a matter of fact, you could argue that media consolidation undercuts all of the underpinnings of FCC's traditional media regulation.
American media policy reached a real turning point in the early 1980s when Ronald Reagan was president, and when he used his position to encourage the FCC, and to the extent that it was possible, Congress, to change the regulatory structure that limited how many stations any one media company could own. Historically, the FCC said that ownership limits would be the policy tool for making sure that there were competitive local media markets, and for making sure that there'd be a diversity of perspectives in any place in the country. And in fact, throughout the 1980s and early 1990s, we saw the ownership caps on broadcast stations rise at a fairly steady rate. In the 1990s, we saw a sea change, and this was, of course, no longer the era when Ronald Reagan was president. Bill Clinton, a Democrat, was president, although the Congress, both the House and the Senate, were controlled by Republicans. And Clinton was very enthusiastic about the power of new technologies, like the internet, for instance, to create a kind of communications revolution. while Clinton was pushing hard for these kinds of technology shifts in media policy, Republicans in Congress were pushing hard to gut the media ownership laws. They wanted to get rid of as many of the constraints on corporations that own media companies as they could. And in the process of creating the 1996 Telecommunications Act, Clinton and the FCC and Congress essentially decided that they would reach a compromise. And while Clinton could get his way on the information superhighway, Congress would get its way on broadcast ownership.
Today, when President Clinton signed the Telecommunications Act of 1996, he ushered in a complete revision of communication law written 62 years ago.
In the 1996 Telecommunications Act, we did something truly radical with our media system. Up until that point, it was illegal for any company to own more than 40 radio stations in the country. And it couldn't own more than, and no company could own more than four stations in any local market, 2 AM and 2 FM. The 96 Act changed all of that. It raised the ownership limits from 4 to 8 in large cities. So one company could move into a town like San Diego and have 8 radio stations. But it also got rid of the national ownership cap altogether. Literally went from 40 to infinite. And of course, what happened in the days after this act passed is an incredible shopping spree.
As conglomerates swallow up newspapers, magazines, publishing houses, and broadcast outlets, news organizations are folded into entertainment divisions. The news hole in the print media shrinks to make room for ads, celebrities, nonsense, and propaganda, and the news we need to know slips from sight.
The more people gathering news, the more likely it is that somewhere in the middle of this large crowd will be found the truth. Today, that middle is occupied by 5 mega media companies, much more interested in the price of their stock than they are in going an expensive kind of investigative report that may go nowhere. By the way, I have the dish. I have 600 channels in my house. But 400 of them are selling the Bowflex machine. And the rest are jewelry and Jesus. This is not diversity. This is the most fabulous, influential, effective selling tool in the history of civilization. I speak of radio and television. They follow you into the bathroom.
It didn't take long for the effect of the Telecom Act to increase media ownership concentration. A report called A Review of the Radio Industry found that the Telecommunications Act of 1996 had led to a drastic decline in the number of radio station owners, even as the actual number of commercial stations in the United States has increased. The report said the reason was, quote, primarily due to the mergers between existing owners.
After the 1996 Telecommunications Act passed, we saw almost like an Oklahoma land rush for radio stations. Within 2 years, I think the vast majority of American stations have been sold, if not once, sometimes twice or three times. And you saw this huge new world emerge with Clear Channel and a few other companies owning hundreds, or in the case of Clear Channel, over 1,000 radio stations. And it was disaster for American radio.
Well, I do believe in setting a cap on the number of media outlets that a company can own. I think that that's important to preserving diversity and as many voices as possible. And ultimately, I think that's important for democracy. When you place too much under one corporate umbrella, you wind up with one point of view and a message that is predicated on what's important to the corporation.
I am concerned about consolidation and the role that these large corporations play in trying to affect content on the type of stories they cover, how they cover them, confusing entertainment for news, confusing the public often with that, presenting it as news when in fact it's either entertainment or editorial. And you have to be a very good consumer and be paying attention, and I don't think everybody's a good consumer of news in this country.
One radio corporation, Clear Channel Communications, grew to be a giant, owning triple the number of radio stations owned by the second largest owner, Cumulus. Clear Channel Communications, owning almost 1,200 radio stations, also owned KLSD in San Diego.
One of the unique parts of the Clear Channel business in particular is that Clear Channel didn't only buy the radio stations in most parts of the country, they also bought the national programs like the Rush Limbaugh Show or Dr. Laura. So that meant that Clear Channel stations were playing these nationally syndicated programs that were also owned by Clear Channel, and they were playing those at the expense of the local programs that had been on the air before companies like Clear Channel took over.
Lowry Mays, the CEO of Clear Channel, who's very clear when he says, and I quote, "We're not in the business of providing news and information. We're not in the business of providing well-researched music. We are simply in the business of selling our customers products."
Clear Channel's founder, Lowry Mays, is a large contributor to the Republican Party and to George W. Bush's presidential campaigns.
It's hard to say whether the programming decisions are politically motivated or whether they're economically motivated or some combination of the two. I mean, there's no question that the Mays family enjoyed a relationship with Republican leaders in Texas, which is their home state, and that included the Bush family. There's no question that Clear Channel executives were making contributions to the Republicans at a rate that was atypical for the industry. You know, most media companies will hedge their bets and try to give fairly evenly to Republicans and Democrats because you never know who's going to win the next election. Clearly, musicians have grown quite concerned about this kind of climate of fear that they say was created by companies like Clear Channel. People heard about this, the playlist of 150 or so songs that were banned on Clear Channel stations after September 11th. There's a controversy over where the ban came from and whether it was in fact followed.
Isn't it ironic?
Together we cry.
Make my way back home with a 35.
This is great. This is great. Balls of fire.
But most musicians will tell you that the Dixie Chicks story is scary.
In South Carolina, I ought to say goodbye to the Dixie Chicks, and anybody that thinks about going to that concert ought to be ready to run away from it.
Hurt our men fighting overseas who think their cause is just.
Their opinion is so ignorant.
They don't know what they're talking about.
Dumbest bimbos, with due respect, I have seen.
These are callow, foolish women who deserve to be slapped.
Concern that a giant radio company has the power to really diminish sales for a band by not playing their albums on the air if for some reason the politics of the music offends the executives who run the radio company.
Radio executives are apparently not too offended by conservative commentators' opinions. For example, Rush Limbaugh's inflammatory rhetoric.
Ladies and gentlemen, there can be no other way to say this now. The gloves have to come off. It's time for people to sober up. The President of the United States, Barack Obama, is destroying the United States economy.
Talk radio really became popular when President Reagan repealed the Fairness Doctrine in 1987, allowing broadcasters for the first time to have an equal platform that our print brothers have always had since time began in this country. We could finally speak freely without having to worry that somebody was going to object and turn us into the Federal Communications Commission for possible license or revocation. Michael Copps has been quoted as saying that a radio station or a market cannot produce the kind of radio to truly reflect the diversity of that market, then government has a right to step in. It's a very scary statement. It's a very, very scary statement. That is a... I don't know about you, but it sounds like a dictatorship to me and a little bit of tyranny in that.
The Fairness Doctrine, which was created by the Federal Communications Commission in 1949, it required broadcasters to cover controversial issues with some opposing views. It required neither the internal balancing of programs, nor for equal time, nor for all opinions to be heard. It merely prevented broadcasters from airing relentless, one-sided propaganda.
The impeachment of President Clinton in the late 1990s provided an opportunity for conservative radio to soar. Rush opened the door for other conservative talkers, including President Reagan's adopted son, Michael.
Anybody who would do that doesn't deserve to live. You shoot them. You call them traitors, and you shoot them dead. I'll pay for the bullet.
I'm thinking about killing Michael Moore, and I'm wondering if I could kill him myself or if I would need to hire somebody to do it. I think I could. I think he could be looking me in the eye, you know, and I could just be choking the life out. Is this wrong?
That wasn't the cries of the downtrodden. That's the cries of the useless, the worthless. New Orleans was a welfare city, a city of parasites.
So radio became more sensational. It became more personality driven in the commercial radio sphere. And you had, you know, the rise of someone like Glenn Beck, who now is excoriating what I think of as good Christian people, saying those people who are talking about economic justice and social justice, beware of them because they want to take your pocketbook. They just want to give money to the poor that your hard-earned money represents.
I have done a lot of talk radio for this book that I just wrote, and by a factor of maybe 8 or 9 to 1, it's all conservative radio. You know that the debate that's going on, the public discourse that goes on in this country is dominated, at least in radio terms, by some of the most extreme voices. And I know from these interviews as well that they're not just of one side or another, but it's very hard to have a factual discussion with some of these people who say that, for instance, the president's a socialist or numbers don't count or whatever it is. So it's not healthy. It distorts the politics. And there clearly needs to be more balance.
Liberals hopes to give Kerry a boost this fall on their new radio network, their answer to conservative talk radio.
It's a new one.
Here we go.
Okay, see you later.
10 seconds. 3, 2.
Broadcasting from an underground bunker 3,500 feet below Dick Cheney's bunker, Air America Radio is on the air.
Those programs, along with the local Stacey Taylor show, provided San Diego, a longtime conservative stronghold, with its sole outlet for progressive talk radio.
Well, you know, having an outlet like KLSD and Air America allowed me to, for example, just personally, not only to be on the talk shows during the hours that people listen, Stacey Taylor in the morning, John Elliott in the evening. It allowed me to talk directly to people about what I was doing. Because if I was on any of the other shows, they would start fighting with me immediately. They would discredit me when I hung up or before I was on. I mean, the power of that talk shows are very great to influence how they're going to look at you.
By pictures now, you can see coming from our affiliates out of the San Diego area as well as the Los Angeles area.
At the same time, wildfires were raging in San Diego County and all over Southern California, resulting in deaths and widespread destruction. The responsibility of radio to respond to local emergencies was tested.
8:06 on the Stacey Taylor Show, as we continue with relatively limited resources, me and Craig basically trying to marshal, Craig and I trying to marshal the stuff together today in terms of reporting on the fire and what's happening right now and taking your phone calls. So I guess you will be our field reporters out there in around the county. Whatever you see or whatever you know in terms of road conditions or fires or evacuations, please let us know. Barb in Rancho Penasquitos, thank you for calling. You're on KLSD.
Good morning. I'm going to give you my report from this area. I rent a place on the corner of Carmel Mountain Road. And
even when you're involved in stuff that is not ideological, like the fires. I mean, I saw Duncan Hunter and Brian Bilbray and Darrell Issa, Republican congressman, on a lot of shows, and we have to fight for some coverage. That's the nature of media in San Diego.
Clear Channel held a fire relief event at Qualcomm Stadium. Its local stations broadcasted live, including Stacey Taylor. Activists showed up, created a sign that said, Save KLSD. The sign was made out of donated dollar bills.
in San Diego, you know, you just went through these catastrophic fires, and everybody in San Diego knows how important it was to turn on the radio and get updates from, you know, people in different parts of the city, to have someone on the air who sounded like she knew what was happening in your city, who understood the relationship between different neighborhoods, who understood who the political players were.
Wade Douglas is a trusted newsman in San Diego. He worked at KOGO AM 600 for a long time, San Diego's largest news talk radio station, before being let go in 2009. Clear Channel owns KOGO.
Localism is the thing that sells best, and if you want to monetize it, you're going to need to be local. It's as simple as that.
Low-power FM stations are the ultimate local radio. They serve a very small area, up to a circumference of several miles.
Another good use for low-power FM stations is they've been very valuable in times of emergency. And so when Hurricane Katrina hit, for example, a lot of the bigger stations went down. A lot of them didn't have a local presence beyond maybe one person in a studio, didn't have a lot of incentive to keep operating. There was a low-power station that stayed on the air by one of their volunteers wading through the floodwaters with a battery on his back to power their low-power transmitter, and that was how a lot of people got information.
Media reform advocates were outraged that a report written by the FCC had been suppressed. The 2004 report was eventually leaked to Senator Barbara Boxer. It was called "Do Local Owners Deliver More Localism? Some Evidence from Local Broadcast News."
Local ownership, this is a quote, adds almost 5.5 minutes of local news and over 3 minutes of local on-location news. That's over 5 minutes for each 30-minute local news broadcast. In the course of a year, this means locally owned stations provide over 33 more hours of regional news, news that's directly relevant and important to viewers. You know, this comes out with a very clear response to the question of consolidation versus localism, and we have a pro-localism bit of information, non-biased, compiled, clear, defended, and it never sees the light of day. Thank you, whoever sent this to me.
Radio is by far our best local medium. It is the natural medium for local stuff, much more than newspapers, certainly more than television and anything else. And the reason is the cost of doing radio is very low. It doesn't, the cost of putting on a credible signal is not that high. You can do a great signal for a pretty low cost, which means that you don't need a huge market to support it. So a city like San Diego could probably support a lot of independently owned radio stations, a big market like that, without any trouble whatsoever. And the reason why we got rid of those ownership limits weren't because those stations were losing money. We got rid of them because these huge companies wanted to become monopolies and make even more money. And as a result of that, what happened is that we lost the localism, the genius of radio, and radio lost a lot of its attraction. And radio became really a much weaker medium than it should have been. It should have been, remained, and should still remain our greatest medium, our greatest local medium. Radio in particular is of utmost importance for poor people, for communities of color, for young people. It's traditionally been their medium of choice. And by turning it over to a handful of enormous companies to basically run out of some central office has really stripped it of its value to no small extent. And it's been one of the great tragedies of American history, and it's a warning to what happens when we have corrupt policymaking. And the corruption of the policymaking that changed radio can't be exaggerated.
One of the tools to ensure local communities are being served is the license renewal process. With the 1996 law, that changed.
Now it's just every 8 years, and it's a virtual rubber stamp process from the FCC. A broadcaster sends in some documents and says, we've been good, and the FCC rubber stamps it and sends it right back to them without much review. There's been very little citizen involvement.
I just interviewed FCC Commissioner Copps. He says that this renewal of licenses has to be taken seriously. It has almost become automatic. There is a corporate charter. There is a responsibility to serve the community. If they're not, they should have their licenses revoked. And there's no better place to start it than in San Diego.
The The situation at KLSD and other liberal talk stations was happening in an era of great FCC interest in media ownership regulations. Back in 2003, spearheaded by FCC Chair Michael Powell, the FCC voted to loosen the rules governing how many stations one company could own in each market. There was a huge public outcry. Congress intervened, and eventually the courts put an end to the FCC efforts. Fast forward to 2007, and Chairman Martin has proposed even more deregulation.
You're asking why the rush and why no notice? And so, let me respond. Throughout the process, I've been as transparent as we can, as I could be. An opportunity to end up
running this hearing with 5 days' notice and then trying to jam media consolidation through by mid-December, to me, is damning evidence by the total abuse of the process itself that you're up to some kind of no good. If this is a legitimate issue, then it deserves and demands a legitimate public process to determine the outcome. You ought to be ashamed of yourselves for not respecting the democracy you live in.
I'm a Republican and I'm a capitalist, but some areas of our private sector must be regulated.
Did you ever notice that the FCC is always ready to run the fast break for big media, but it's the four corner stall when it comes to serving the public interest?
Unfortunately, judging from the way this hearing was arranged, it looks like the media conglomerate's agenda is far ahead of yours at the FCC. Now, if you see a proposal for more consolidation made quickly after this final hearing, you'll know your input was dismissed.
There's a camp believing that ownership of traditional mass media in a few large hands is of no import, considering the proliferation of new media and other factors.
I guess I'm going to take a little bit of a different view on this, because in the world that I've been living in for the past few years, we've been experiencing the total opposite of consolidation. We are in the midst, in the internet, of probably the greatest democratization of the media in history. Before the last few years, you needed hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not millions of dollars, to create the infrastructure to get out information, which left that information in the hands of a very small amount of people. I know the FCC things are important, but I would really not, if you look in the long term, in the next 5 to 10 years, I don't see them being that huge of a deal. You have newspapers on their websites that are producing radio and that are producing video. You have TV and radio stations that are on their website producing print.
When we then are losing our community radio stations and our community newspapers, it leaves us very, very vulnerable to having the fear in our community stimulated and having people stampeded based on fear as opposed to led based on facts.
One of the greatest benefits of the internet, one of the greatest benefits of what has happened with digital technology now, is that people are faced with a huge array of possibilities in terms of getting at the truth.
I remember talking to a guy who was a program director in Minnesota, one of the top stations there, and he said, look, I really like your show, and it's exciting, it's energetic, it's great. The problem is our entire station is conservative, so you don't fit in the programming. And I said, okay, great, where's the liberal station? He said, it doesn't exist. So you're telling me I don't fit in the programming of any station in Minnesota? And he said, that's right. Even though I really like your show and I think the audience would respond to it, no one will put you on there.
What still influences the vast majority of Americans is television, radio, newspapers. The very people who are being shut out of the process of our media are the very people who don't have access to the newer forms. I'll just use a statistic on minority ownership. I mean, there's less than 3% minority ownership of broadcasting and other media today. So, and if a minority is a particularly low income, then you're not going to have access to the internet. So you've shut out, you know, a third of the population right away from a real understanding discussion of the news of America.
November 9th, 2007, the Stacey Taylor Show ended, taking with it San Diego's only progressive talk format.
Nothing will take the sting out of not doing the show anymore. because this was the deal. This was the whole enchilada right here.
Yeah.
Right here in Morning Drive, accessible to the largest audience in San Diego. That's who listens to radio, people in the morning, basically.
Right.
And we go to the phones again, and here is Joan in Sabre Springs. Good morning, Joan.
Hi, Stacy. How are you guys?
Good. How are you?
Well, I'm hanging in there. I'm holding back some tears this morning, but I'm looking for big rays of sunshine in the future with you guys. Listen, the reason I'm calling is first to thank you guys for all you've done, you and Craig, Lenny and Kelly. It's just been fabulous. I was not a radio listener before till you guys came around. And like Pam, I learned about you through word of mouth. And you guys have really been a lifeline to me, and I know many others in the activist community at times when things have been just so tough and frustrating. And I hate the fact they're taking off just when we really need you the most.
Hi, Mitch. What's going on?
Oh, my God. I'm just so emotional today. I wanted to congratulate you. San Diego Press Club's 34th annual Journalism Best of Show Radio category. Dude,
I know. How about that, huh?
On a more emotional note, my daughter is very upset. She's 8 years old. She can't stop cursing and blaming Bush for the demise of our station, and she wants to say goodbye to you. Hold on just a sec.
Okay.
Say goodbye to Stacy.
Bye-bye, Stacy.
Oh. Now, who's this? What's your name?
Sydney Jade Sterling.
Sydney, yeah. And you listen with your dad in the morning?
I listen with my dad in the morning all the time. And I went to all the protests.
And, well, you know, you fought the good fight out there, Sydney, and so did your dad. You fought the good fight, and that's all you can do. You know, sometimes you just sort of, you got to hit your head up against that rock, and eventually it's going to break. And so that's all I can ask of anybody, including you. And at a nice young age like 8, it sounds like you're already on your way to being a very involved citizen.
I am. And no matter what, we're going to keep fighting for KLSD.
You know, that's almost too much. I'm going to put you on hold. Thank you very much for that. Have a great weekend, and I'll see you down the road, Sydney and Mitchell. Thank you much. And I can't take any more phone calls here because I just can't. I got to get out of here. And I really...
Fox Sports Radio, The Mike Norris Show.
Henceforth, KLSD would be known as Extra Sports, leaving San Diego with 3 sports talk stations, 5 conservative talk stations, and not a single progressive talk station.
But now the sports station didn't even make the book. They didn't even get an audience, so that doesn't explain why they have switched there.
For inexplicable reasons, we have now lost Air America. We've lost the only progressive radio station that we had in San Diego, one of the biggest urban markets in the country. We were told it had to do with ratings and advertising.
The situation in San Diego, I believe, is tragic because after they made the switch, they didn't bill any more advertising and they had 1/3 of the ratings. There was a huge drop in listenership on that radio station.
Roger Hedgecock was mayor of San Diego in the mid-1980s. He is now a conservative talk radio host. He always claims that KLSD 1360 did a format switch because of business, not partisan politics.
It isn't so much they didn't get listeners. They got some listeners. But they didn't get listeners who would buy anything, and therefore they failed in the marketplace. Now, Clear Channel, who makes a lot of decisions, and some of them are good and some of them aren't good in the market, made the decision to go with sports because they felt sports would make it there. I personally didn't think it would. I don't think it's going to. But as Brian was saying, they actually, whoever is listening to that, is buying stuff because they're young males, basically. They're buying stuff more than those listeners to Air America did. So believe me when I tell you, the Clear Channel really does not care. I know they're the big boogeyman and everybody thinks they're conservative. In terms of the people who invested in Clear Channel, they could care less what's on the air as long as it's selling stuff.
The month after KLSD died in November of 2007, the FCC contemplated that proposal from Chairman Martin. It would further loosen media cross-ownership rules, allowing newspapers to own radio and television stations in the same market.
What he's proposing is that for 46% of the population of this country, the daily newspaper can buy one of the television stations in town. I frankly don't think that makes much sense. What is the urgency to require that to happen or to allow that to happen? What voices is the chairman listening to that suggests there needs to be that opportunity?
The big FCC vote did come.
Unfortunately, back in December, on the 18th of December, the Federal Communications Commission, in a party-line Republican vote, voted to lift a 32-year-old ban on cross-ownership, which would have prevented a newspaper and a TV station from being owned by the same corporation in the same media market. They've lifted that ban, pretty much ignoring incredible public comment and public testimony. 99% of the public that showed up at public hearings, that submitted their comments online, are against further media consolidation. Unfortunately, the FCC vote did not reflect that.
In a big victory for media reformers, the court struck down the ruling in July 2011. So for now, the cross-ownership ban remains. Just after the demise of KLSD, a freshman senator from Illinois was about to astonish the country with his drive and bid for President of the United States.
On this January night, at this defining moment in history, you have done what the cynics said we couldn't do.
The election season was the perfect time for host Stacey Taylor to return to the airwaves.
1700 AM San Diego, 1700, and we will be likely doing this every night from 4 to 7.
Just 6 weeks after leaving KLSD, he began hosting a program on a small station airing mostly conservative talk, AM 1700. I saw Stacey broadcast live during the presidential debate listening party. The party was organized by the Save KLSD activist group that became known as CPR, Campaign for Progressive Radio at first, and then later known as Campaign for Press Reform. Just 1 month after the election of Barack Obama, the 44th president of the United States, the last embers of progressive talk in San Diego came to an abrupt halt yet again. Stacey Taylor was let go from AM 1700. In 2008, Clear Channel was taken private by two equity firms, including Bain Capital, co-founded by Mitt Romney, the 2008 and 2012 Republican presidential candidate. In 2009, John Elliott came and went on AM 1700, and in 2010, Air America itself was over.
It was looking grim for liberal talk, but there were high hopes with a new progressive-sounding president and his new FCC chair. However, by 2011, it was clear not much was changing in terms of media reform.
I think that there's been widespread disappointment with the Obama administration and the Obama FCC under Julius Genachowski, given the campaign positions that Obama campaigned on, and that Julius Genachowski was in charge of a lot of these communication policies in the campaign. I think the expectations were very high. We had had a real strong commitment to oppose media consolidation from the Obama campaign. We had a strong commitment for internet neutrality, for localism in media. President Obama, as candidate Obama, and even as president, has repeatedly announced his understanding of the central role of journalism in having a free society. But I fear that's what's happened, and this is something that's my interpretation, is that the way politics works in Washington, D.C. is money talks. And there's a lot of money talking on radio. There's a lot of money talking on communication issues. And the Democrats are listening, like the Republicans. And I think the deal they've made is we're going to take this money and we're going to be play ball with these guys. And that'll help us win elections and stay in power. And then we can do good things in other issues. But this is one area that's going to have to be sacrificed so we can make the money to compete and win good fights in other issues.
Money plays way too big a role now. More than three quarters of all of the campaign money raised in both political parties is now spent on 30-second television ads, and the amount goes up every single year. And the only place where they can raise that much money on a regular continuing basis is from special interests and business lobbies, and they end up calling the tune.
We asked a member of the Obama administration, and we were told it, surprisingly, does not have a position on media consolidation.
It's a very unsettling line to suggest that the Obama administration does not have a position on media consolidation. The fact of the matter is that, you know, the President of the United States should be involved in the major issues of the Republic. And there's simply no question that media consolidation, the consolidation of ownership of our different tiers of media, broadcast, print, and internet, is a fundamental small-d democracy issue. The president should have a position, and those who work for him should be actively engaged in talking about that.
Policymaking at the behest of the largest companies across industries is threatening our economy, our oceans, our security, and the very viability of our democracy. Allowing the Comcast-NBC merger would be yet another giveaway to industry titans at the public's expense.
Federal regulators today approved the purchase by Comcast of a majority stake in NBC Universal from General Electric.
So how did this deal happen? Well, the FCC's five-member regulatory board voted 4-1 to approve the merger, thanks in part to the support of FCC Commissioner Meredith Baker.
Commissioner Meredith Atwell Baker voted for the deal and has since been outspoken, complaining that the FCC's merger review process is cumbersome and takes too long.
Good for you, Madam Commissioner, cutting through the red tape to save time and money for the American taxpayer. Finally, someone in government is not just looking out for number one. I see big things for Meredith Baker.
Federal Communications Commissioner Meredith Baker announced she's resigning next month to become Comcast NBC Universal's Senior Vice President of Governmental Affairs.
So while conservatives continue to dominate talk radio, a new law is a big win for the Free Press Group, Prometheus, and other advocates. The Local Community Radio Act, originally introduced by Senator John McCain, spurs the creation of more low-power, non-commercial radio stations that are responsive to community needs and views. But that's no substitute for full-power stations with bigger budgets that can reach much larger audiences. There has, however, been an upswing in progressive views on TV.
So I'm not sure how clear it is whether or not America...
Dysfunctional Fox News family right into the zone.
Good morning from New York. I'm Chris Hayes. The New York Times report...
Good evening. I'm Elliot Spitzer.
I'll tell you what. You might not believe...
...to a lot of trouble.
And I teased who I talked to yesterday.
Interesting. And by the way, if he's a pro-corporate guy, which I agree with you, he is...
...to testify otherwise. We can thank the Koch brothers.
A number of legislators.
And NPR, National Public Radio, has been doing well.
If you take, like, Fox, CNBC, CNN, you combine them together, and you've got still more listeners than you have viewers of those three stations on NPR. So it's considerable.
As for San Diego, Stacy Taylor hasn't been on the air here lately. He does host programs from KGO, San Francisco's talk powerhouse station. KGO features views from the left, the right, and sideways. Efforts are underway to start community radio stations in San Diego and to increase the diversity and localism of radio. The Voice of San Diego website is a perfect example of nonprofit journalism. Voice of San Diego is branching out into TV and radio and serves as a national model of how new media can serve the public interest. And the demise of KLSD had a silver lining. It sparked a media reform effort in San Diego that continues to this day.
Provocative actions and ideas are churning. However, it does not appear that fundamental deep reform is within reach anytime soon. Ongoing incremental change is more likely. The corporatization of America fueled the situation in media and other sectors of society. Big business and big money continue to hold enormous power. And that ability to influence reaches a disturbing level when it threatens the availability of a free press, a diverse local press on our publicly owned airwaves. We end with some thoughts on where we are and where we may be headed.
We were graced with the eloquence of the power of Mario Savio's words from these steps about the importance and centrality of freedom of speech and assembly and freedom of expression and social justice.
One of the absurdities is the notion that we have created a consolidated media system and that this has somehow become natural. This is what we must live with. That's simply not true. 10 years ago, we couldn't have this level of consolidation. 15 years ago, it wouldn't have been allowed. And there is no reason why we can't reverse some of that.
The conventional wisdom in the industry is nobody ever got fired for putting Limbaugh on the air. Slowly, the
the conventional wisdom is becoming nobody ever got fired for putting Randy Rhodes on the air. Nobody ever got fired for putting Tom Hartman on the air. As that, you know, Rachel Maddow and so on, as that takes place, as that takes hold, as increasingly the world of program directors who live in fear, as those people get it, this isn't a risky venture. This is Middle America. And this isn't just a, you know, West or East Coast venture. This is all across the country.
I think in the current political environment, hoping that Washington is going to fix this is not going to happen. This has to come from the grassroots.
I'm here because I feel very strongly that we're not going to turn this country around if we don't turn the media around first. We have to take back public control of the airwaves.
You can't have a change movement without change media. I also believe that this younger generation is so hungry for information and for change, and they're so technologically savvy that, you know, hopefully they will be able to come up with some of the alternative media that maybe even will have bigger impact than some of the cables. I hope so.
And media are not supposed to be the ruling class. Media are us, individual citizens. So I often like to say that if we're not doing something as a citizen, patriot, about media and talking about the problem of media, then we're probably not being a true patriot.
And here's what I think we need to communicate across this nation. First, we need to let everybody know that media reform is justice reform. Secondly, we need to let everybody know that media justice must be a movement of average, ordinary, common people recognizing the value of media diversity. And we cannot win economic justice without media diversity. We cannot win racial justice when the media is controlled by a few white guys. Working together for the common good, we must stand up and say we are the leaders we've been waiting for. I close by sharing a quote from Bobby Kennedy. He traveled in South Africa and saw the world strung out with apartheid. He came back to the United States and he said this: "Let no one be discouraged by the belief that there is nothing.
The belief there is nothing one man or one woman can do against the enormous array of the world's ills, against misery, against ignorance, or injustice and violence. Yet many of the world's great movements of thought and action have flowed from the work of a single man. Few will have the greatness to bend history, but each of us can work to change a small portion of the event, and in the total, all of these acts will be written in the history of this generation."
We are the leaders we've been waiting for.
The smart way to keep people passive and obedient is to strictly limit the spectrum of acceptable opinion, but allow very lively debate within that spectrum. Noam Chomsky, 1998.